Thank you, Wouter, for this introduction. The commercial talk is on your own initiative, and I guess you're trying to get me a little bit out of balance here. Thank you for inviting me to this conference and also to this beautiful city. It's a pleasure to be here. Let me start with this short movie. This is an image of one of our latest ultrasound images. It's what I think is a stunning 3D image of a baby. And it's only fair to say that this kind of stunning images are only possible on an economic scale with the use of microfabricated devices. I think you all are familiar with a normal cross-sectional ultrasound picture that's made by a simple linear array of ultrasound transducers which are driven by a phase delay so that you can steer an ultrasound beam in a plane. But these kind of complex 3D images are made with 2D arrays. So actually this image was, or this movie was made with an imager consisting of 100 by 100 ultrasound pixels, which all need to be driven individually. And that poses an interconnect nightmare. So how are these transducers made at the moment? We start with an ASIC, a large ASIC, and on top of this ASIC, a slab of ultrasound materials is solder bumped with 10,000 bumps. And then finally, this whole slab of material is diced into 10,000 individual transducers. It's a very expensive process with a low yield and very complex to make. It's a fabrication nightmare. That has stimulated the development of microfabricated ultrasound transducers. And this is one of them on the left. It's basically nothing more than a simple pillar box consisting of two metal plates. Typical diameter of 50 to 150 micrometers with a vacuum gap in between of a micron. And when you apply a voltage to the top plate, the two plates collapse and it generates an ultrasound beam. It sounds very simple, but technologically there is a little bit more to it, but this is basically what it is. And this is an example of how microfabricated devices really are moving towards the front end of all kinds of medical equipment and generating and driving innovation there. For myself, I like to distinguish in medical devices three kinds of markets. We have the traditional markets on the bottom, which is there, where Philips is very big in, where the growth is not that much. We have large amounts of silicon transducers already in PET scanners, CT scanners, especially spectral CT scanners. And I showed you the example of how microfabricated devices are going to make a big impact in ultrasound. Then on top of that, emerging is a new market, the emerging markets. And they are mainly in the areas of minimal invasive instruments, smart catheters, imaging catheters, but especially also in point of care diagnostics. And then again, behind that, there is our new markets, which are now still basically largely in research. So for instance, the area of implantables, where a lot of things are going on. They're moving towards electroceuticals, small implantables, but also organ on chip and smart body patches. And from both new markets, I will show you some examples. And in all these cases, the microfabricated devices really form the interface between the system and the living matter. And there we have a problem. I think most of you will recognize this as a typical silicon chip. It's made of brittle material, hard, sharp. It's not flexible. It's certainly not stretchable. And the human body, on the other hand, is totally different. And somewhere these two worlds have to match each other. The human body, it's as you can see, flexible, stretchable, it's soft, it can easily damage. So one of the big tasks in my kind of work is to make silicon or microfabricated devices adapt to the human body, because certainly the human body won't adapt to the microfabricated device. Certainly we wouldn't want that. An example where this already plays an important role is in one of the most common minimal invasive procedures. It's in angioplastic surgery, or stenting, as it's sometimes called. So some people develop a blocking in one of their coronary arteries. It gives them pain in the chest. It limits the blood flow to the heart.
And the common procedure which is being done at the moment is that they make a small hole in your groin. They first insert a tiny 300 micron diameter, as it is called, guide wire. It's maneuvered on the X-ray screen to the point of the stenosis. Then it serves as a kind of a train rail for the other instruments, such as, for instance, the stent with the balloon with the stent over it. But also other instruments could be shifted over this guide wire. And at the moment, most of these procedures are being done just by using an X-ray screen, by using a faint and moving image on an X-ray screen. And everything that we can add on sensors and imaging modalities on these type of instruments are very welcome to the cardiologist. Now, when you want to put instruments in a very small volume, and you all know that more than I do, if you take, for instance, a phone or a camera, if you open up, the standard thing to do is you take a flex foil, you put your ICs on it, your sensors, your passive components, whatever, and then you fold this up into this very small volume. And that's exactly what we want to do on the tip of those catheters. The only thing is that standard flex foil technology is not suitable for that because they come from large area electronics and it's very difficult to scale that really down to the very small dimensions needed here. So what we developed is a kind of a flex foil technology which is more or less similar to, which comes from the area of IC processing. So we're using microfabrication to make those flex foils. They allow for arbitrary shaped devices. You see the devices are round so that they fit into the coronary arteries. They can be partially flexible so that we can bend them through arteries. And it's really a platform technology. It's suitable for all kinds of imaging and sensing modalities. This is a little bit, you can see how it works. It's a somewhat older example of a 360 degree ultrasound microphone. At this stage, the whole device is finished. No human hand has touched it. We start with fabricating this device on a planar silicon wafer, and in this case, all the silver dots you see are individual ultrasound transducers. And then the individual elements are singulated by separating, by etching the silicon from the backside of the wafer. And in the end, you have this structure hanging in the silicon wafer, ready to be assembled on the catheter. I always compare it with these model airplane toys, where you take those structures out of the frame and then glue them together into a small airplane. And this is basically the same, but then on a very small scale and for large boys. So what you do, you take the device out of the frame and it's glued on the tip of the catheter and folded around it. And then you have this device. Now, what we are working on is further miniaturizing this. This is a device of 2 millimeter diameter, and we want to go to smaller diameters and more complexity. This is an example of an IVUS catheter. IVUS stands for intervascular ultrasound. It's an ultrasound device which makes a radial image of the arteries from within the coronary arteries. It's used to look at plaque formation, but also to look at stent deployment after angioplastic surgery. And what you see here in the design, I took here a photo of the design because that's easiest to see what's going on. You see here 48 tiles, which are individually 30 micron wide, and on every tile there are two rows of ultrasound transducers. And they are connected by a piece of flex foil here to another silicon tile, which can contain an ASIC for signal processing. And this is how the device looks in reality. See here, it's a tiny device. It's suspended in a frame that can be taken out of the wafer, brought to the point of assembly, and then finally the device is taken out of the frame and fitted around the catheter. And in this case, it's a 1.2 millimeter diameter catheter. And we are even working towards smaller devices where part of the ASIC is inserted into the transducer to make the device even shorter so that it can go through the smallest turns of the coronary arteries. And here, here you see this folding, and this, I included this picture, although it is a somewhat larger device. I included it because here you can see how this folding works. Take the silicon frame, the silicon form out of the silicon frame. It's glued together and then wrapped around. I told you that the guide wire is the first instrument to insert. And putting sensors and imaging on this guide wire is especially interesting because it doesn't require another medical intervention to have this instrument inserted. It's already there. If you want to have, so already that, although the guide wire is there, every instrument that you insert into the patient is a risk for the patient, but it also takes time and it costs money. So since the guide wire is always there, it's very advantageous to put as much as possible sensing functionality on this guide wire. But since this is only a 300 micron diameter wire, you can imagine that it is very challenging. It's not only about making the things so small, but also about very mundane things like decoupling capacitors. You people, you know that better than I, behind and on and next to every chip, you like to place a whole row of decoupling capacitors. But how are you going to do that in a device which is only 300 micron in diameter? A capacitor won't fit in that. Something as stupid as an ESD protection diode. The smallest ESD protection diodes I know of in a commercial process are about 150 by 150 micron. If you need 30, 40 connections in such a guide wire, you don't have the space. So these are very practical problems that you have to solve to bring electronics in these very tiny instruments. This is an example of a device that we made. It's a flash, it's a pressure flow sensor. Here you see a silicon tile, 200 micron in width, with a piece of flex foil connected to it. And on this piece of flex foil, there are three flow sensors. And this piece of silicon just is there to handle the whole thing. Here you see how it's inserted into the tip of a guide wire, wrapped around the guide wire, fixed, and then you have a flow sensor which can flow, sense flow in on three sides on the tip of such a small instrument. And it really works. You see here a shear pattern, a shear rate pattern that we enforced and the measured shear rate. This is an example of a structure on such a small scale and how it is folded into something which is can, in the end, be a circular or a kind of cylinder ultrasound transducer. And here you see it compared with the human hair to give you an idea how small these devices are. Communication to those instruments is one of the biggest challenges. You cannot do any data signal processing or data compression at the tip of such an instrument, so you have to go out with raw data. And surprisingly enough, these transducers can generate anything up to 500 to a gigabit per second. Sending those signals over a few thin copper wires or golden wires, it's not practical and it's even impossible. So what we are looking at is doing that in the optical domain. VCSEL lasers can be very, very small. And what a student of mine is working on is integrating a VCSEL layer in the laser in the tip of such an instrument to go out in the optical domain and to have actually the optical fiber be the core of the guide wire. This is another example, a very nice example of a minimal invasive instrument that we have made. It's a 3D intercardiac echo. So this application is not for within the coronary arteries, but it is to make actually real 3D images from within the heart itself. It consists here of a 2.5 millimeter diameter ultrasound transducer array, a 2D array, which is connected here to two silicon tiles, one silicon tile for the ASICs, which are necessary for signal processing, and one silicon tile for the few passives which are required. And then a final silicon tile for the electrical interconnection. So this is a somewhat larger instrument where we can use passive components. Here you see the device taken out of the frame and glued to a metal support. And here it is compared to a device which is made with standard flex foil technology and with a mesh. And then you can see that it is with modern technology and with cleverness, it is possible to make. So this is a complete ultrasound transducer. Everything on it. It makes a complete 3D image and it has the size slightly larger than a match head. One of the problems with these instruments is when the cardiologist enters the heart, it is as if he's, because the aperture is very small, it is as if he's looking through a tube. It's a very small field of view, so it's very difficult for him to find his way initially into the heart. Only when he is in the neighborhood of the point of intervention, it becomes clear where he is. So what you ideally would like to have is a device where you enter the heart and you have an overview, and then when you approach the point of intervention, you zoom in and see more detail. And that's what we are trying to make with very similar technologies, but now not using flexible materials, but with using stretchable materials. So what you see here is a membrane, 3 millimeters in diameter, and on every membrane, on the membrane, there are silicon tiles, 100 by 100 micron. They are connected by stretchable interconnects, and on every tile, in this case there is not yet, but there can be an ultrasound transducer. And in this way you can make a transducer that you inflate slightly when you enter the heart chamber so that you have a kind of overview image, and when you approach the point of intervention, you deflate the array to get more resolution. This already looks a little bit living, I would say. And this is a membrane which is indeed living, or at least let's say there is living matter on it. This is a membrane made in more or less the similar technology, which is stretching, and on top of this membrane there are cells being stretched. And it's an example of what we call organ-on-chip. It's a new field of research in microfabrication, but also in biology. And when I explain to my students organ-on-chip, I always start with this image, because what is the most fundamental thing of all beta science? It's making models of reality. Reality is complex, so you want to make a model of it. So if I ask a physicist to make a model of rain, he will probably start with taking a test tube, putting distilled water in it and a cork, and then he will heat it and cool it and look at condensation. And then he will find that this model is too simple, and he will start to change the acidity of the water or add dust particles until the model represents reality. And then you have a simple thing to test on and to prove your hypothesis. Surprisingly enough, that is not really the case in life sciences. So this is a picture of Alexander Fleming. And what you see him working on his table with all kinds of glass petri dishes and broths in tubes and so on. And basically, that is actually what they are still doing. So if you look in their model incubators, you will find petri dishes, weld plates, they're small petri dishes, but they're basically doing exactly the same. So they're using cells, which are often from an unknown origin. They have been tempered with to be able to make them divide so that you can keep them in culture. And then the environment where these cells are being kept in is completely unrealistic and not comparable to the human body. And what has become clear the past 10 years is that cells really interact with the tissue around them. To give you one simple example, if you take a heart muscle cell from the heart and biopt, put it in a patch clamp device so that you can measure the ion channels, then you will see that this cell exhibits all the characteristics of an adult cell. But after a few days, the cell will notice that it is not contracting. It will shut down some of these ion channels because it will differentiate back or go back to an earlier stage in its development. And that holds for most of the cells in the human body. That is one of the problems for pharma at the moment. Pharma is really lacking good models for the development of their drugs, and not only for the development of the drugs, but also to screen their drugs, for instance, for toxicity. And that's one of the devices that we have been working on. So when you have an eye for it and when you read the newspapers, you will see regularly that medicines are withdrawn from the market because people are suffering from heart arrhythmia. So these medicines go through all the clinical tests, and then when the medicine hits the market, people start having problems. It's caused by these drugs, which are often small molecule compounds, which they have to be because they have to pass all kinds of barriers, for instance, in the brain. But these molecules very often or regularly interfere with the ion channels in the heart, resulting in arrhythmia, like torsade pointe, which can very easily develop in something like ventricle fibrillation or sudden death. Now, all medicines have side effects, but when you drop that, that's a very serious side effect. And these medicines are then also immediately withdrawn from the market, which every time when a medicine is withdrawn from the market costs pharma $1 billion. So that's a big problem. So pharma wants to establish as early as possible in the development of their drugs if a medicine is cardiotoxic or not. And what already is becoming the golden standard is to take a a chip like this with electrodes on it, plate heart muscle cells on it, and then look at the field potential of these cells. And when you subject those cells to a drug compound, and this is an example of a drug compound where it is known that it is cardiotoxic, then you will see that the repolarization phase of the cell increases, and this is a strong indicator that this medicine can be cardiotoxic. And if you can monitor that as soon as possible, you can stop the further development of this drug. Now, one important factor which is missing here is exercise. Most people don't drop dead when they're sitting, like you in the audience, but they drop dead when they are running or cycling. And that's because the cells are then being stretched, and that physically changes the shape of the ion channels, which can result in a different behavior. So we made a MEA device which is stretchable. Again, more or less using the same technology as I showed you before, where we make things first on silicon and then remove the silicon from the backside. And in this case, we used an elastomer instead of a flexible material. So you see here a membrane. The whole device is not more than 3 millimeters in length. On the membrane, there are electrodes which can be stretched, which lead the electrodes, the interconnects, which lead the signals to the silicon exterior. And then in the center of the membrane, you see grooves which are being used to align the cells so that it forms more or less a tissue. And these grooves in the membrane, cells can really sense topography in surfaces and they align themselves to those grooves. I will show that later on. Here you see a top view of such a device where the cells are plated on, and you see the cells actually contracting, and these black dots here, they are the electrodes sensing the signal. And here you see a first proof of principle where we have the top signal is the unfiltered signal, where you see large artifacts due to the stretching, the cyclic stretching of the membrane, but you can filter those out. And then on the lower trace, you see the real ECG of the cells while they are being stretched. When you take such a piece of foil with those cells on it, and by the way, here you can see, you see the grooves and you see how these cells are aligned. When you take such a piece of foil with those cells and you cut it out and you put it in a culture medium, the cells will start to contract spontaneously. That's what you see happening here. So this is a device, as you might call it, a very simple device, where cells are actually used as the actuator. So this thing is moving just because cells contract. The energy from the movement comes from a direct conversion of the glucose in the medium to mechanical energy. And that is something which is really behind organ-on-chip, and that is where a field which is coming up, where we are going to use living cells in microfabricated devices to perform certain functions. To give you a simple example, you might use this movement to generate electricity in an implantable. And there is already a Japanese group who has experimented and has connected such a piece of fiber with a piezo device and generating tiny amounts of electricity every time this device contracts. Why is this now so emerging, this field? And that has to do with a very important invention or discovery in 2007 by Gurdon and Yamanaka, for which they received the Nobel Prize in 2012, and that is iPS technology, iPSC. What I didn't know in the past, I was an ignorant technologist, is that you cannot culture adult cells. So if you take a biopt of your liver or of your heart and put them in a culture dish, then these cells are so differentiated that they won't divide anymore. The only way to get those cells is from a stem cell. If you take a stem cell, which is a cell which forms after an egg has been fertilized, then these first cells which generate still have the ability to divide and to differentiate into a specialized cell. And what biologists can do, they can take a stem cell, they can keep stem cells in cultures forever, and then when they need it, they can differentiate such a stem cell into a specialized cell like a heart muscle cell. Now, you know there are big ethical issues with stem cells, but what Curden and Yamanaka discovered was that you can take a skin sample of somebody, reprogram that into a stem cell-like cell, keep that in culture, and then at any given moment, differentiate that into a specialized cell, like, for instance, a heart muscle cell. And that is something mind-blowing, and something which is going to revolutionize several sciences. And the reason is that you can now make I can now take your skin sample, reprogram that into a heart muscle cell or a retinal cell with your genetic profile. And that is something completely new and something very exciting. That is the reason why also this organ on chip is now so hot in the world. At several places in the world, institutes are being formed where microfabrication is brought together with cell biology to together develop models which can represent organs in a simpler form to aid pharma. And this is an example of it, of an institute that we have at the moment just formed in Holland. And another very well-known example is, of course, the Wyss Institute in Harvard, who has really pioneered this whole field. Okay, beautiful. But where are we going to make those strange devices? Because much more than your regular CMOS or MEMS devices, these medical devices really require a potpourri of microfabrication, assembly, packaging, molding, microfluidics, and on top of that, they almost always include some form of polymer processing. Just because the fact that these polymers form by nature a much nicer interface with living matter than silicon. And for a medical device, you on top of that have to do it in a certified manufacturing environment. Now that is something that we have that we are addressing in Holland and at Philips, where Philips has taken the initiative to form a pilot line for these kind of devices, hosted by Philips itself. In the first place, of course, I won't deny that for their own devices, but since the capacity is large enough, we can also host other companies and even SMEs who want to fabricate their medical device under certified circumstances in an industrial environment. And we do that in the framework of a large European project called Informat. And what is unique in this project is that we bring together, we form, as it were, a manufacturing network with different manufacturers who have different expertises, and we all integrate them into one integrated pilot line for medical devices. So in summary, micro devices are and will become the interface between man and machine, and we have to work on it to make those microfabricators devices adapt to living matter, to men, to cells, and to tissue. To do that, we require much more technologies than we need for the regular CMOS or MEMS devices. And to make that happen, we will pilot lines are needed where we can make those devices, where they can be validated and demonstrated in the market. And it will be almost unavoidable if you really want to bring this off the ground, to form European manufacturing networks or other networks, other manufacturing networks to make this happen. Now, as a teaser for my students, I always show this movie, which is unfortunately not by myself, but by Kit Parker from Harvard. He has done more or less the same. He has also made a piece of foil, but now in the form of a star, which is at this moment still on silicon, but he's going to release it. And on this piece of silicone foil, he has cells, like we did, cells plated, aligned also in a star-like pattern. And when you release this piece of foil from the membrane, he does it with a layer which dissolves in water, and when you paste it, you put two electrodes in the water, these cells start to contract, and in this way he created an artificial jellyfish. Now this is just a very nice demonstrator, not really useful, but it demonstrates where technology can go to in the coming years. I would like to thank you for your attention.